This over here is table salt, or its proper formula name is sodium chloride. Now, we know that it's composed of sodium atoms and chlorine atoms. It is ionically bonded, and we know this because it's the bond of a non-metal with a metal. So that is an ionic bond. Now, what if we would like to separate the sodium from the chlorine in order to obtain the individual elements? Is this possible? Well, we have a couple of problems that we're going to have to overcome. First of all, we said that NaCl is ionically bonded, okay? So the bond in between Na and Cl is an ionic bond, which is extremely strong. In fact, ionic bonds form crystal lattices that look like this. And so if you were to try and separate them, you would have to break every single one of these ionic bonds. So that's going to require a lot of energy. That's our first problem. But what we can do is let's heat it up anyways. Let's heat it up to its boiling point, or to its melting point, I should rather say, which is around 800 degrees Celsius. Okay, so what that will do is it'll simply separate or break these bonds. But that still isn't going to give us sodium and chlorine. Because when this breaks up, it's going to break up into a sodium ion and a chlorine ion. That is not pure sodium and that is not pure chlorine. So let's go find these on the table. And so if we look on the table, we've got Na plus up here, and we've got Cl minus all the way down here at the bottom. Here is problem number two. We saw in the previous lesson that if you want something to be able to react spontaneously or naturally, we would need the substance on the right-hand side to be higher up than the substance on the left. Remember that? So we clearly have a problem here. We've got a substance on the left that is really high up, which means that it's a very weak oxidizer, and we've got a substance that's very low down on the right-hand side, and so it's a weak reducer. So a reaction is actually not going to take place. We're not going to be able to make Na plus just simply turn into Na, which is what we want, and we can't take 2Cl minus and turn it into Cl2. It's not going to work naturally. However, us as humans, we can solve problems, and so if we can somehow add extra power into the system, we can override the system and we can cause a reaction to take place. This is why we need electrolysis. Electrolysis gives us the ability to separate things that wouldn't naturally separate by themselves. And so here we go. Here we have an electrolytic cell. An electrolytic cell uses a battery. The battery is what allows us to do things that wouldn't naturally be possible. So what we would have done is we would have taken that table salt, heated it up like crazy to about 800 degrees Celsius so that it turns into a molten substance, and we would throw that into the electrolytic cell. And so what you would have is these Na pluses and Cl minuses floating around. And so here's where the magic happens. The battery induces a charge that is negative on this electrode, which is positive on this electrode. And so naturally, what will now happen is the Cl negative, or the Cl minus, is going to be attracted to that electrode over there, and the Na plus is going to be attracted to that over there. And what happens is that when you have a battery, the electrons flow out of the negative terminal. If that part right there confuses you, it's because your whole life teachers have taught you that the conventional current goes from positive. That is correct, but the conventional current is not actually the same as the electron current, okay? Electrons do not flow out of the positive, electrons flow out of the negative. So Kevin, why do we have that difference? It's because of the way that science was developed hundreds of years ago, okay? They are slowly trying to get rid of that confusion, but yes, electrons flow out of the negative terminal of a battery. And so the electrons are going to flow down here and cause a whole lot of electrons to be deposited over here. Now this will naturally attract the sodium ions, and so the sodium ion can now accept those electrons and become sodium. And so we will have a reaction taking place on this electrode, which will be Na plus plus an electron gives us sodium. Okay, so we're going like that. Then on the other side, we've got the Cl minus, which is going to be attracted to this positive terminal. Now this terminal is positive because there is a lack of electrons. There are no, or there are hardly any electrons on this electrode. So what happens is the Cl minus goes to that electrode and it reacts. And that was according to this reaction down here. So we've got the Cl minus. Don't worry about the 2, that's just the ratios. So the Cl minus is going to turn into Cl2 plus 2 electrons. So Cl2, 2 Cl minus gives us Cl2 plus 2 electrons. And so those 2 electrons can flow off and complete the circuit. So you've got electrons that are being given to the sodium, and then the Cl minus is giving away electrons, and so we've got a transfer of electrons going around the entire circuit. And so guys, well done. We have achieved our goal, and that was to take NaCl and break it up into its components. We have broken it up into sodium, and we've broken it up into chlorine. The only reason that the chlorine has a Cl2 is because chlorine is diatomic in nature. So we've just produced chlorine, and we've just produced sodium. Fantastic. So we use electrolysis to separate compounds into their individual elements. This process is not natural. It would not take place by itself. If you leave sodium chloride and you stare at it for long enough, I promise you, when you open your eyes or when you look for after half an hour, it's still going to be sodium chloride. To be able to separate it, you need a battery. That's it for this lesson. Thanks for watching.